welcome you all to Al-Furqan, the Islamic Heritage Foundation. We deal with Islamic civilization, and most of you will know by now that Islamic civilization is like no other civilization. It has a diversified interest. Roman civilization was known with architecture. The Greek civilization was famous with medicine and philosophy and so on. Islamic civilization really has a real diversification. We are famous with law, with literature, with medicine, and all fields of science. We are the pioneers in science, and you might know that Western civilization in the field of chemistry, medicine, astronomy, and so on, and mathematics were based on the Islamic civilization. We are famous with architecture, and for those who had a chance to visit south of Spain, the Andalusia, will know that for sure. We are famous with music, and we contributed so much even to Western music. We are famous with art, and so on. And the intention of the Al-Furqan, this foundation, is really to introduce that part of the true Islam. Nowadays, unfortunately, we are living with an ugly face of Islam, presented by those who are coming, unfortunately, from our part of the world, and terrorism is linked to Islam, and Islam is anti-terrorism. Today, we will start our series of lectures by our famous professor, Dr. Ibish. We will deal with art and artisans. Next month, we'll deal with music in Islamic civilization, and it's going to be a very unique lecture with someone, the greatest scholar in the Arab and Muslim world, who will let us know about music from the time of Prophet Muhammad until these days, together with his instrument. So he will let us know what kind of civilization we have in that part. And then we will move to law, and we will give you a lecture on the on democracy and Islam, for you to know that without democracy you cannot have a Muslim state, and so on. We will have Anne-Marie Schimmel giving us something about the philosophy in poetry, a very famous philosopher, and so on. And today I'm really proud to start our series of lectures with someone I admire, and I owe him so much for his help to our foundation. Professor Ibish is a member of the board of experts. He's by now exhausted. He spent hours and hours working in this room to help us in our work in this foundation. But just to let you know a little bit about this man standing in front of you, he's a great scholar. He, of course, studied in several places, but his PhD is from Harvard in political science and Islamic studies. From Cambridge, he was teaching at Harvard, at Cambridge University, and other universities. And finally here, he was a senior scholar at the Cambridge University in this great country since 1990. And he's the chairman of the Islamic Cultural Center, but now I think he will resign from that. I don't know for what. All right. If I want to introduce him to you, I will take so much of your time, and that's really unfair to you and to him, because what you will listen from him about the corporations of the artisans in Damascus in the Ottoman era. And I will leave you with him, and I'm sure we will benefit so much from what he will say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to start by saying I'm not the expert, that you expect me to be. And you realize by the end of my talk that there are various degrees of ignorance. I happen to be somewhere there. Our subject is the corporations of artisans of Damascus during the Ottoman period. Therefore, we are talking about a span of time that started in 1516 with the Ottoman expansion into the Arab world and ended with the end of the First World War in 1918. That's a period of about 402 years, to be exact, of continuous Ottoman presence. Now, the period that preceded the coming of Sultan Selim on his invasion of the Middle East was a very important period. I think there are few dates that are of great importance, not only in the sense that they happened historically, but in the sense that they were of historic dimension, that they caused history. One of these dates is 1453, when the Ottomans occupied, conquered finally Constantinople and made it their capital. It's the end of an era and the beginning of a new one, which is characterized by a beautiful letter written by Muhammad the Fatih, the conqueror, to the Sharif of Mecca, in which he says in that letter, "I bring you good news. What you have launched in 633, I have completed today." In other words, he was aware of the push towards Byzantium that the Muslims have started in the big invasions, and now he has completed the task. But that's the beginning of a new era, that's the push into Europe of Islam, returning, so to speak, the carte de visite of the Crusaders back to Europe, knocking at the gates of Vienna more than once. Now, this is a very important date because it changed the balance of power in the Mediterranean. The peninsula, which is Asia Minor, was Christian throughout, and now it's become Muslim. And a few years later, 4 or 5 decades later, Granada fell, and the Muslims came out of Spain, which is 1492, the end of 8 centuries, brilliant centuries, of Islamic Moorish culture in Spain. I need not repeat what is there even today to see of that brilliant moment in history where 3 or more civilizations met in one place. Again, this contributed to this change in the balance of power because the Iberian Peninsula now, which was Muslim for 8 centuries, is now Christian, and the Asia Minor became Muslim. The whole balance of power in the Mediterranean changed. Equally important in date is the same year that Granada fell, 1492, was the discovery of America. And therefore, the rising energies in Europe were absorbed in an opposite direction. One hand, the Ottomans were pushing, the other, America was pulling. The El Dorado, the idea of mountains of gold, the idea of new conquests, and if you remember, they were after going to India. The first discoveries were West Indies, because they thought that they were going to India. And they did not give up. Even the discovery of America did not give up, made them give up India. For in 1498, which is very close. 1492, the fall of Granada, 1492, the discovery of America. Now 1498 was the circumnavigation of Africa by Vasco da Gama. Vasco da Gama circumnavigated, and for the first time, Western fleets came into the Indian Ocean and the Arabian Sea. Prior to that, no European known fleet ever came there. The Greeks tried several times through the Red Sea, the Romans tried, they never did. And by the way, the exit to the Indian Ocean, Arabian Sea, from the Red Sea is called Bab al-Mandab, the gate of whaling. Means you go, you're not coming back. And the problem was a problem of mass and winds and monsoons in that region. And the irony of it all is that Vasco da Gama was able to circumnavigate Africa with the help of an Arab sailor, Ibn Majid, the famous Arab sailor who helped him cross, and they set foot on the Indian subcontinent in Goa, followed shortly by the famous Albuquerque. The name suggests that he's of either Arab origin, he carried an Arab name, Abu al-Qirq, which is the cobbler in Arabic, the cobbler, the repairer of shoes, or maker of shoes. Anyway, Albuquerque's presence in the Arabian Sea, his attack on Muscat, his attack on Aden, his siege of Jeddah, changed again the whole perspective. Then Sultan Salim on his way to Tabriz. The Battle of Shaldiran was it about 1514? And he stopped there after conquering Tabriz. He didn't follow the Safavids to Isfahan. He turned around and came into Syria. Why did he come? It's a very important question. I think he went there to conquer Egypt, Syria, the Levant, and secure his southern and eastern flanks. After he was sure that the Safavids were not his match in battle, he simply knew that from then on his soft belly was in the Levant, in Egypt, in Arabia. So he moved into the region. So the third power in the Middle East, other than the Safavids and the Ottoman Turks, were the Mamluks, and they were in a state of decadence. As Ibn Khaldun calls it, a state that has exhausted itself in idmahlal, in the stage of idmahlal. And it proved it. It took only two short battles, one in northern Syria, Marjdabiq, in 1516, and one in Egypt, Redania, very famous, in few months between. 1516 in August was the battle of Marjdabiq, and January was the battle of Redania. So about 6 months, the whole Mamluk Sultanate was finished. So he occupied Syria, Egypt, and Hijaz followed, because Hijaz was part of the Mamluk Empire, Mamluk Sultanate. Now, what does it mean? What did it mean? It meant he was consolidating his southern flank and eastern flank, because his eye was on Europe. His eye was not on the Middle East. And we have ample evidence that the Ottomans felt that this area was important to them strategically, And it was also important because of its spiritual importance. It contained Mecca and Medina. It contained Jerusalem, Damascus, Aleppo, and it contained Cairo and Alexandria. And these names for any conqueror in the world are great, really, to have his hand in hands on them. And we have also ample evidence that they did not want to colonize. They wanted to incorporate. And let me say outright that from my study of history, I can say that the Ottomans provided the universal Islamic empire for the peoples of the area. They were not colonizers in the sense that, like the British or French later, or any other European power that came in. It was a universal empire. They were the sultans. The empire was the people. And a letter from Muhammad, Sultan Selim to European powers, and his son, Suleiman the Magnificent, to King of France. Francis is very important, because they address him as I, the Padishah, the Sultan of Sultans, the ruler of this place, that place, the Arabs, the Turks, the Armenians, the Persians, the ruler of this region, that region. I'm addressing this note to you, Francis, the King of the French, limiting him to the King of the French. He's the universal empire. Now, I shall not repeat now, but later, perhaps, what Sultan Abdul Hamid, one of the last sultans, told Herzl, who came to convince him that he wanted Palestine as a homeland against which he would cover his debts. What did he tell him? That this is not my empire, this is the people's empire. So when Sultan Selim arrived in the vicinity of Damascus, he encamped in Kabul, an area known close to the city, and we have wonderful records. There was a wonderful historian, Ibn Tulun al-Dimashqi, Salih al-Dimashqi, who wrote his daily memoirs, daily events of what he saw. First, he saw the Mamluk Sultan, Consul Ghori, come and leave ceremonies and on his way to meet Selim, the King of the Romans, Malik al-Rum, he calls him. And then he records what happened, and Ghori died in battle, and everything fell. Damascus surrendered without battle. They sent word, and then finally, when he arrived, the ulama and Ahl al-Hal wal-Aqd, as they call them, those who loosen and tie, went out to meet and surrender the city. And among them was Ibn Tulun. He was a alim, a historian, and it's a rare moment when great historians meet great conquerors. It happened before when, ironically, in the same place, Ibn Khaldun met Temurlan outside the gate of Damascus to negotiate again the surrender of the city. And Ibn Tulun records to us what happened in those moments, historical moments, how he met them briefly, how he accepted the surrender, appointed the officers to take over the garrison and the citadel, and how he simply dismissed them without any ceremony, and entered the city twice, once to have a bath, and he records exactly how he rode in, how they took the bath over, and he came out like one of his officers, trim beard and clean shaven, and back to his camp. And the second time he came in was, to the surprise of everyone, was to call on an obscure, unknown person, a sheikh, in one of the little quarters of the city, who was apparently a Sufi, and he knew about him, and went and alone entered the house. No guard, nothing, except outside, and sat there for an hour and left to appoint a group of masons to build the mausoleum of Ibn Arabi, which exists today of that era. And he came finally to a prayer at the mosque, at the Umayyad mosque, with his officers, and he had with him muezzins from Isfahan. And he said, Ibn Tulun says, we have never heard such voices, such beauty, gave a lot of money to the poor around the mosque, rode away to Egypt. Now, what did he see? He came, obviously, he conquered. He must have seen something. You know, the famous Vine Vide Vici. What did he see? He saw a city that looked something like this.
This is after the famous historian, French historian, Sauvage, a city which is walled, divided into quarters, a Jewish quarter, a Christian quarter, and the rest of the Muslim quarters, with a mountain, Salahiya, and a huta around the city. This city has sustained the weight and brunt of two huge attacks. One, the Crusaders. For centuries, the pressure of Europe was around the city and was the seat of Sultan Salah ad-Din and the Ayyubids, and also the attacks of the Mongols that came from the east. So for centuries, it stood its ground and fought, sometimes tragically, as in the case of Timur Lang, who occupied it and put a lot of people to the sword, and most of the time very defiantly and victoriously. And this does not mean that it was a city that was well defended. In fact, we have every evidence that it was a city well knit, a social fabric, so well knit that it could withstand political change and continue and prosper. It had regained its position as a center of learning. It had produced great historians, great thinkers, great theologians, and a city that, according to a description of one Damascene of that period, Ibn Abdul Hadi al-Mubarrad, a famous Damascene historian who died a few years before Sultan Salim, that had 134 specialized souks or bazaars. It had 620 mosques and masjids. It had 40 caravanserais. It had about 19 khanaqa and ribat, 92 madrasas, of all shades of Islamic teaching, including two medical schools and three bimiristans, hospitals, and it had 15 churches, 9 monasteries, 117 baths, and 14 gates. A real metropolis, counting probably 80,000. And it had a tremendous workforce. Here I must say that the ecology of the city itself helped in the sense that not only it had a ghouta around it, a large garden of some 30 square kilometers, it was supplied with fresh water from a very good river, Barada, about 6 cubic meters per second of fresh water. It had Quran for a bread basket, and it had the beka for fruits and vegetables and cereals too. Baalbek was only 40 kilometers from there. And in spite of the fact that it was only 100 kilometers from the Mediterranean Sea, it never acquired Mediterranean character. It remained predominantly a desert city, with the mountains of Lebanon and anti-Lebanon as tremendous barriers in those days. In fact, if you read Ibn Khaldun in his Muqaddima on what to observe in building a city, there is no way but to think that he was thinking of Fas and Damascus and some other cities, because all the conditions he put are there. Strongly defended by mountain regions on one side, the desert on the other. Skirmishes, yes. Bedouin encroachment, yes. But nothing serious could come from that, because there was no water to sustain an army to come from that way. Riding across north-south trade routes from the dawn of history, because it is maintained that it is the oldest continuously inhabited city in the world, and there is a reason to believe that, because there were a few others that went into oblivion. They say Ariha, but Ariha until very recently was a very small village. And this, you're talking of a big metropolis. Now, that position of generous surroundings, productive surroundings, impose on the city a kind of attitude of what towards work. And it developed a marvelous system of production. Here again, one cannot help but marvel at the fact that the city did not only had productive system around it of raw material, it developed local market. Damascus became the local market of a radius of about 100, 120 kilometers of villages, of Bedouins, of other small centers that came to buy their manufactured goods and sell their raw material, and therefore it was a processing city, a city that processed its goods. And gradually it developed a system of, if you want, artisanal corporations. Let me add to this that every year, annually, the city expanded to accommodate a large number of people compared to its population that were on their way to pilgrimage. It became a center
for pilgrimage, and it resembled a little Mecca. Mecca annually expands to accommodate all these pilgrims and then dwindles until recently to a small place, very modest, preparing for the next season. Ibn Jubair, the famous Arab traveler, likens Mecca, and later when he saw Damascus, to what happens in pregnancy, how the womb expands to accommodate the child, and then it's given birth. Damascus had this twice a year, on the way in and on the way out, because there was the annual procession to Mecca as the last big center for the pilgrims to buy what they need to make arrangement to cross the desert. It took about 35 days to cross from Damascus to Medina and Mecca. And after the pilgrimage, they came home. So on the way, they brought goods. From Iran, they brought rugs and saffron and other important things. From Turkey, the same thing and more. From Central Asia, from the Black Sea region. They all converge on the city. They exchange the goods for what they need to cross, and when they came back, they had sold what remained and bought African goods and goods from the Far East and came back to sell it. So there was a tremendous bustling economic activities. And the Damascenes became accustomed to the faces of the pilgrims, to languages, to people from all sorts of places. And in fact, they settled in. Damascus had a marvelous source of fresh blood, if you want. Cities tend to disintegrate people, tend to spoil them. And not only European historians and social historians said this, but Ibn Khaldun says, the worst thing that could happen to people is to live in a city, because gradually they lose their basic characteristics, rujula and the rest of it. They become dependent, they depend on walls, on everything, and finally they become degenerate. And it needs always an injection of fresh blood to renew its vigor. And Damascus was such a melting pot that it contributed to the Arabic grammar of a verb. The damshaka or damshaka is to become Damascene, to acquire the characteristics of a Damascene, and that's for people who came from all over the place. There were quarters for people who came from Kurdistan, and it's called Haylakrad, it's still there. There were quarters for people who came from Bukhara, and there are Harat al-Bukhariya, and so on and so forth, the Cherkas, the Arnaut, the Muhajirin were all from Europe or the Balkans. So it's a city that integrated people in. More important, I think, is a very process of socializing people. In general, a Muslim belongs to his family, his immediate family, extended family, and Islam. But in the Muslim urban centers, and by the way, there are people who interpret Islamic civilization as an urban civilization, you have a process of socialization other than the family. Of course, Islam is against blood relationship to start with, against tribalism, in favor of an ummah in which all are equal, all are before the Sharia and before God on equal footing, and the only distinction possible is possibly function, that is, of this group or that group, as
Islamic society was divided, stratification, I wouldn't say class, because class is a European term that is charged with ideas from Marx, from Weber. I would say it was stratified into four main groups. One is Ahl al-Sayf, the rulers, the bearers of the sword. Ahl al-Qalam, the ulama and the udaba and the rest of them. And then Ahl al-Tijara wa al-Sina'a, and this is one group, manufacturing and trading. And then Ahl al-Zara' wa al-Dara', the people who are in the villages and look after agriculture and animal husbandry. These are the basic four stratas of society. So in Damascus, not only you belong to your family, and this is not peculiarly Damascene, this is true of almost all urban centers in Islam, but you get a process of being socialized into a trade. You now become a member of a corporation. I'm trying desperately to avoid the use of an English term, guild. Guild, again, does not apply because guilds in Europe have a special meaning, have a special connotation. These were corporations of people, voluntary association of people doing the same work. And hence you move from being Fulan ibn Fulan ibn Fulan to Al-Hallaq or Al-Najjar or Al-Haddad. Now you have another identity, so to speak, which is related to your profession and therefore related to civilization. Because a man who does not produce, a man who does not work, a man who does not contribute to the happiness of others, to their well-being, is not a man. That civilization involves production. And in the case of cities, and Damascus is one of them, almost all able-bodied people were involved in some production. And I say almost all, I mean almost every all. Women, young people, men, almost those who are physically unable. So the work labor of Damascus, I calculated thrice in that period, once because Sultan Selim left us also a very good survey, as all conquerors do. He left officers and they surveyed the town. They counted the shops, they counted people, they counted workers, they counted everything, even animals. They estimated over 30% of the people were productive. So the system of production involved everyone gainfully occupied. Must be in a particular corporation. Must be doing work according to a specific pattern and must be subject, above all, to Islamic Sharia. In other words, so the individual, and that's what is interesting for me, it's not what they produced, what happens to the individual. The child who's put at a shop or workshop to learn a trade is not only the son of so-and-so, of such a tribe, and even the maternal side is important in extended families, as we know. They're all equal, but these are the makhwalhum, so-and-so. Well, this exists in Damascus. But he's now involved in a profession and involved in a process of production which is related to civilization. And in gainfully occupied under Sharia, that his mouthful is halal. This was very important in these cities, including Damascus.
Now, each of one of these corporations had a structure. Sometimes one could say a rigid structure, but it had a structure. And this structure is very interesting because it relates to something else. You see, the apprentice, the child, usually his child started being an apprentice, a mubtadi', at a very early age, around 10, he's put in a qa'da, they call it. He sits in the shop of some mu'allim who's accepted him. Now this mu'allim becomes his father in trade, Ab Bilkar. He's responsible for the upbringing of that child as much as his parents. He starts by learning the names of the tools, helping in cleaning the shop, running errands, and he is put through a system of ta'deeb. The ta'deeb is not only a certain pattern of behavior, but a way of speech. How he treats the elders, how he treats his equals, how he greets people, how he walks in the street, coming from his home to the workshop or the bazaar or the souk, how to stand on attention when he's spoken to, how to remain silent, how to keep his ablution between prayers. All of these were inculcated on this mubtadi' level until he becomes more or less acquainted and proficient with the tools and with producing something. Once he reaches that level, then the sheikh of the hirfa, or the car, having a shawish, a sergeant, who is not necessarily a proficient person, but a helper, starts urging him that so-and-so and so-and-so have become proficient, and they prepare them for transition from mubtadi' to sani', journeyman. This involved a process of initiation, shad they called it. And they usually did it in spring in one of the gardens of the city and under highly ceremonial situation, they spread a green carpet, Bisat al-Ahmadi, they called it, which is the Bisat of the Prophet. You know, Ahmad is nickname of the Prophet. And they made them stand there, take the oath, and it's a long, elaborate process. They girded him with a belt, this is a shed, and they tied knots for his sheikh, for his ma'allim, for his sheikh, for sheikh al-mashayikh, for naqib al-ashraf, all the way, and therefore tied to the ashraf, and all the way back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and through him to other prophets, way back to Adam, that God has molded with his hand, his tina, and breathed in him life. So here again, we find that the young fellow is charged now with belonging to something else other than his family, no matter how famous the family. He now belongs to the Ummah of Islam. He belongs to those who accepted the message of Islam from the Prophet, through him to all the Prophets, on to the first man. Therefore, in him there is something of Adam. There is something of the Risala of the Prophet. And in him there is the responsibility of being the bearer. It's not just, admire me, I'm here, I'm the descendant spiritually of this and that, but he has to behave in a manner that shows that he is that.
So he becomes a sani', a journeyman, and to move to muallim, he has to produce something that indicates not only proficiency in his trade, but indicates his faith. Because here, amal and iman must be tied together. You have to produce an object that people looking at it will provoke them to contemplation. Some will say, mashallah, mashallah, you know, subhanallah. Unless you produce something of that sort, you cannot move to the status of muallim. And the status of muallim, you become member of the hirfa council, and out of this council, a sheikh of the hirfa is usually selected. I didn't say elected, selected, because it's the same process without a box you drop a vote in it, dimawi, dimono, that is out. They selected someone by his qualities, his proficiency in the trade, his personality, because he's going to be connected with others. And Sheikh al-Mashayikh of the city, all the hiraf are tied to him. He becomes the connecting force, and to the Naqib al-Ashraf. So not only the hiraf, but all the trades, the merchants, and all the Mashayikh Sufiya were all in that group, under Sheikh al-Mashayikh, under Naqib al-Ashraf, and through Naqib al-Ashraf to Naqabat al-Ashraf in Istanbul. And Naqib al-Ashraf in Istanbul, correct me, Professor Sanoglu, was a very important personality in the center of the empire. He kept the Sanjak Dar, where all the standards for the armies are in his hand. He guarded the Sultan when he succeeds to office, puts on him the sword of the Prophet, which is in Topkapi Sarai. And don't ask me if it is a true sword, because if they believe so, it is the true sword. That's all there is to it. And became a very important person vis-a-vis the public. The Sultan is, as the name suggests, power. People, why should they obey the firman of the Sultan? Someone stands and say, he reached his power by the sword, he knows nothing about Sharia, he's a wonderful man defending Islam, but why should I obey him? How do I know that this law is correct? It's Naqib al-Ashraf and Sheikh al-Islam that guarantees the constitutionality, so to speak, of every firman that came out. And this little apprentice down there, this journeyman, feels that he's tied to all that system, a conceptual frame of reference. Now, add to this kind of conceptual frame of reference that between the 12th century and the 19th century, it was virtually impossible to profess Islam without being in a Sufi order. Active or otherwise, lukewarm, coming to, you know, warm yourself against that heat, or plunging into it, you have to be in. Again, there you have another silsila. Because through the Muqaddam and the Sheikh of your tariqa, you're tied to the Mashayikh, you're tied to the founders, you go all the way. I will not put any, although I have it here, of the silsila of the Sufis, the Shadhilis of Damascus, or the Qadiris, or the Naqshbandis, or all these orders, tied people also in a conceptual frame of reference. There were the ziyarat to the awliya. Each of these hirfa were tied to a wali. They feel that this wali is their patron. I wouldn't say patron saint, because that again takes us into a different realm, but a patron. And to give you an example, the carpenters in Damascus believed that Noah, Nuh, was their patron. Why? Because he built the ark. He must be a master builder, carpenter. The weavers, and they were very large weavers, they had Maryam, alayhi salam. She was their patron because she wove the cloth that wrapped the child. And so on and so forth. The comb makers believe that Nabishit, one of the sons of Nuh alayhi salam, was their patron because he's supposed to have made the first comb. And I'm not talking of, you know, imagined things, but they believed every action they did, every movement in their trade, everything they fabricated had a meaning because it came from a patron, and it came from awliya Allah, the friends of God. So to work with your hands is an occupation that only saints and patrons have set the pattern. To imitate them, to produce things that are as simple as a, you know, comb made of animal horn, flattened and cut into rough and fine teeth. Nothing so elating about it. But they believe every movement has a meaning. And therefore it became a process of spiritual refinement. You're not only earning a living, but you're refining your soul. The skill is not in the tools you're using, but inside you. And therefore, everything you produce is an extension of yourself. If it's in demand, if it pleases people, if it is like Damascene brocade, the prize of any woman with taste, if it is like the swords of Damascus, the steel, famous throughout the world, then something of the worker, something of his soul is poured into it. And hence the price he charges is only minimal price. His compensation was how he feels. Even if he's in rags. I'll tell you something of my experience, because I did see the last remnants of it. There was at the gate of the citadel in Damascus an old man who carved or put initials or writing on seals, mainly for the villagers who didn't know how to write, the mukhatir, the people, a seal. And I had a seal that my mother had given me, bless her soul, it was three-sided, that rotates, that had nothing on it. So I went to this man, and he charged £2 Syrian for doing this. And I said, could you please do my name, Yusuf Ibish? And he said, the third. I said, put the divine name, Allah. He shook his head. I said, well, he said, no. In my profession, I took an oath to engrave a date against everything that I do. I can put dates against your name, your names, but I cannot put a date to God. I found it a little, you know, elating. It made me happy, but I wanted to test this man. I said, about £25. He looked at me, he said, no. And I had on me 200, which was a little fortune that day. I put the 200 on his little table. He looked at me, he said, young man, you don't understand me. There isn't enough wealth in the world to make me put a date. Take your money, I don't want to deal with you. So they had principles. The man was had a satisfaction, an inner feeling that is important.
that he will not change these little things, that he's not after, as the Damascenes sometimes say, entush fintush, you know, trying to intush. He really stood his ground. And he lived as a poor man with his sweat of his brow and died as a poor man. That is the integration I'm talking about. That's the frame of social frame of reference, the spiritual frame of reference that integrated them. Not only this, but belonging to a madhab, belonging to other things were equally important. So that ultimately the circles in which a Damascene worker or artisan, and these were the majority of labor, so these are basically the circles he lived in. Say, this fellow, I chose the name of a man, Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Sa'id al-Hallaq. Born in Damascus at Dimashqi, like Ibn Tulun al-Salih al-Dimashqi. Al-Hanafi, as far as madhab is concerned, a Shadili for Sufi order. Now this is localized blood relationship. Important because he belongs to a family respectable in the city. This was his profession. And Hallaq, by the way, in Damascus was a surgeon and a dentist. It was not a profession which you can look down upon. He was a respectable surgeon. I think in England they still have that. A surgeon in England is still called Mr., isn't it? Because he belongs to the Guild of Barbers. There it is. It is also there. And then Hanafi, and that's one of the five mazahib in the Muslim world, he's one of them. And then Shadili, one of the Sufi orders. Through his profession, he ties in with the mashayikh that I've described, through his Sufi order to the others. So he lived within a special frame of reference. Let me add something very important in fairness to the Ottomans. They collaborated with these. They never tried to break them. Sultan Selim, when I asked, what did he see? He did not only see a beautiful city, as most of the visitors have always described Damascus as Jannat, God on earth. But he saw actually a working system, a productive system, a coordinated system. And the Ottomans, like many others, worked on the principle, if it is working, don't repair it. If it's working, don't repair it. Keep it. And they kept it. Not only they collaborated with these people and gave the mashayikh and the Sufis and the laborers and the ahya and their zu'ama and the rest of it, their due and collaboration, they actually appointed governors, Hulat from Syria. One of the examples I can give, because we don't have much time left, or do we, was one family, the Azam family, that ruled Syria probably as long, if not longer, than the Umayyads themselves. The Azam family, a family that produced seven walis, seven rulers, the seven governors of Syria. And of course, this is a short genealogical table. Ismail, and then Sulaiman, and then Asad, all of them pashas, Muhammad and Abdullah. were all of wazir rank in the Ottoman Empire. And after Abdullah, his grandson was Muhammad Fawzi Pasha, the last of the wazir al-Qaf in the empire, who's the father of Khalid al-Adam, who kept, in power in Syria up to the 60s, up to Abdel Nasser, etc. So this is an example of collaborating with the existing powers, collaborating not only with the existing families and the rulers. They collaborated with Ahl al-Hal wal-Aqd, they collaborated with the Hiraf, they collaborated with all the structure inside. I have no time to go into the harat, into the quarters, living quarters, how they were structured, but they were highly structured also, and they collaborated with it. What did they want, the Turks? They wanted the allegiance of these people to the Ottoman Empire. They wanted them to pay their taxes that were not prohibitive, I must say, sometimes exaggerated, but not prohibitive. And they wanted them to remain calm, law and order, peace, the Sharia prevailing, and not to collaborate with the enemy. Law and order inside, collection of taxes, recognition of Istanbul. The structure, therefore, of power in the city, which is not peculiarly Damascene, but revealing, I think, looked something like this. It's a very simplified form, but it is important for my argument or the development of my argument. Yeah. So, you have on the one side of the scale, the wali. As we have seen, the wulat were sometimes locally, and most of the times of the Azm family. I see a representative here in this room, and otherwise appointed by Istanbul. In other words, power came from above, vested in them. And these had daftardars, which are the top bureaucrats, holding the sobashi and the police, and holding the taxation system. And on the other side, you have the army, the pasha of the army, the garrison of the city, both on the provincial, on the city level and the provincial level. And these two comprise, now, on the opposite side, let me come to the opposite side, you have Naqib al-Ashraf, almost the virtual ruler of the city. Under him, Sheikh al-Mashayikh, of the Hiraf and the Turuq, under him al-Ashraf, were a special group. Then the merchants and their khanat. Then you have the shuyukh of the Hiraf, the souks, the workshops, the masters of the trades, the sunnah, the mubtadis. And then here you have the shuyukh of the Sufi orders, the Zawiyas and Ribats, and the Sufi, individual Sufis, with their tremendous wealth and awqaf and what have you. In the middle, I put as a fulcrum, the ulama, Dar al-Ifta, the madrasas that were usually, or were not tied to the Sufis, the awqaf, Tarat al-Awqaf, the mosques, and therefore mosque madrasas and madaris, the Sharia court, the judges, and the muhtasib. The muhtasib was not the police, as you see. He was a representative of the qadi in the bazaar. Now these were Ahl al-Sayf, Ahl al-Qalam, this section. And these were Ahl al-Tijara wa Sina'a, Ahl al-Zira'a wal Dara wa Zara were in the countryside. This was a balance of power, in which the ulama played the role of, if you have a nasty wali, a terrible tyrant, they would
shift their weight to the public. If he's a weak and the public are rising, you have the Zohar and the Limpo Proletariat of a city, then they shifted their way there. Because their motto was Sharia must prevail. 60 years of tyranny are better than 1 hour of civil strife, was their motto. And these were of Al-Zahir. These were the Ibn Taymiyyahs of the local place. By the way, Ibn Taymiyyah was from Damascus. I mean, not from Damascus, but lived and produced there, and died there, and is buried there. Now, for reasons that are extremely complex and not sufficiently studied, the whole system broke down, starting with the 19th century. 19th century. Now, I can enumerate some of the reasons, but I would like to dwell on two at some length, not very long. I'm not threatening you all night. There was the European encroachment. You have Algeria occupied in 1830. You have Tunisia followed, Egypt, Sudan, Libya, South Arabia, the Gulf, the British, the war, First World War, the occupation of Syria, Lebanon, Palestine, Iraq, rest of it. Not to mention Central Asiatic also from the Russian side, the attack. So you have the European returning the carte de visite that we gave them, ferociously. You have also, one should admit frankly, sometimes empires, big empires, go in a state of idmihlal. I mean, even Khaldun says, states are organic, they're born, they grow up, they decline, and they die. There's that element. There is the European encroachment. There were ideas radiating from the French Revolution, constitutionalism, nationalism, isms, all of these isms. There were dumping of goods at low prices, the Ottoman capitulations, kills could no longer hold people or supply them. And you have a strange phenomenon, I never got to the bottom of it, namely the old bubonic plague, 14th century bubonic plague, the big one, came to us from Europe. It didn't come to Europe from us. It came through Asia, Russia, Europe, and came back down to us, Black Sea and Marseille and the rest. You know, the bubonic plague is a ravaging disease. It's a terrible disease that kills people, especially in urban centers. But it depends on the cycle between rat, lice, and human beings. One of the three must die to stop the plague. And usually it is the rats that die. Lice and human beings survive. And they start afresh. Now, it came to Egypt and came to the Middle East. And therefore, again, medical people can explain it, it turned into a pneumonic plague, no longer depending on the cycle, but through breathing. It got into the lungs. And hence it became a perennial kind of disease. It flared up once every 25 years or so. Again, devastating. Egypt in the 14th century, or 15th century, when the big plague came, was about 6 million people. When Bonaparte came to Egypt,
and we call him Bonaparte because he hadn't become Napoleon yet. So historically he was still General Bonaparte, and made his census, Egypt was less than 2 million. So it means a steady decline in population. Okay. In the 19th century, it shot up. Plague became less frequent, there were plagues, less devastating, it ceased to be pneumonic, and population started rising. How do you explain it? Many of my medical friends could not explain it. Better sanitation is not an explanation. There were no inoculations, nothing against it. But this is a fact. Therefore, a growth of population, growth of the cities, growth of demand that could not be supplied by the local artisans, that had to be imported, and the Europeans were ready to dump goods. Killing whole trades. I mean, it's unimaginable to calculate how a little thing could destroy so much. Take, for example, a pot, a cooking pot. These, by the way, in Middle Eastern terms, Islamic civilization, these came out with a trousseau of the bride, the cooking pots, and so it killed the trade. What did it involve? I'll give me an example. It involved the importation of the copper to the Khan. It involved the copper moving to the coppersmith to make it into sheets. It involved going from sheets to the man who cuts it and welds it and makes it into a pot with a cover. It involved the tinners, because you cannot use copper pots without tinning. In other words, 6 or 7 guilds died right there as a result of one thing. Not to speak of, synthetic fibers and weaving and the dumping of goods that absolutely destroyed the whole fabric. So what I've described as a balance began to disintegrate. Simultaneously, there was a growth of power of the state encroaching. For example, economic production was never a state affair in Islam, to a society. Education. Decision on education, there was no education department or diwan in any of the known empires we know or states. Now all of it is political, under the state. Administration of justice, but I did not explain to you that these were tension mitigating institutions that people within the Hirfa solved their problems, within the family extended solved their problem, within the Hara system solved their problem. They rarely went to the court except to register, or to our friend's explanation, to the Udul, to Katib al-Adl, to register an ittifaq. That's it. In other words, they kept the state outside the bazaar, outside their personal affairs, outside. They're afraid of arbitrary government. And to check and balance it, you have to take matters in your hand. In the Hiraf, they used to collect the taxes. The Sheikh al-Hirfa would go to the tax bureau and say, what's the tax on us this year, and give a bargain, and finally they settle on so many keys, so many units, and he went back to his group and distributed the burden on capacity, each one according to his ability, collected the tax and paid it. Not because he wanted to be subservient to the state, but to keep the tax collector out. He collaborated with the muhtasib, weights, measurements, all these things, to keep him out. He collaborated with the police to keep the police out. In other words, there was real counterbalancing institutions. These were the sum total of the counterbalancing institutions to the military might of the state. Now, with the dissolution of these, you have the dissolution of the counterbalancing institution, and the individual today stands before the military might of the state. I must say it's all military, almost, unprotected and unshielded, and reduced to his own power. Neither his life, nor his property, nor his liberty can be guaranteed. I'm not talking just of little fries in the street. I'm talking of everyone in society, other than the rulers. Therefore, the dissolution of these traditional institutions created a social void and a spiritual void, because, again, Islam is not something you just believe in abstraction. It has to be application. That today we live a crisis in the Middle East. Most people talk about economic side. There is an economic crisis, there's no doubt. They talk of the political side, the problem of Israel, the problem of power, the relationship with the West, with the East. It's true, they're all real problems. But the real problem which is contributing to the volcanic instability is the social problem, is the lack of these counterbalancing institutions. Now, the question that comes to my mind, and I would like to end with it, is should we lament the passing of the traditional society? Should we cry? Should we sit, pile ashes on our heads? Or what should be our attitude? I think, in as much as it is painful, as much as we are paying prices, there is an opportunity of rebirth, restructure. That is, if we build our societies, and the rulers are going to resist, because that's a no-no, on modern terms, inspired by Islam, i.e. new trade unions instead of guilds or corporations, farm cooperatives, pressure groups, political parties, all of these can build again the counterbalancing institutions to bring the state to terms. We cannot accept inspiration from Western ideals, because that would be abandoning our identity. We cease to be what we are. We become mass proletaria of the world, rather than being ourselves. And most of the uneasiness and instability and confusion, if you want to use the term, you see, are, in my opinion, healthy signs rather than unhealthy signs. Because in a world which is confusing and confused, it's not strange to be a little bit confused yourself. Now, I would like to open the rest of the session for questions, if you have any. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Was I that clear? No, I'm not asking for compliments. I'm really here to answer questions. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much for this fantastic, very important, and for forgive me for my ignorance. I just wanted to ask you, was this condition of what we call the terminology now calls the civil society, was it in all the city, Islamic cities, throughout the Islamic cities, or was it only Damascus, Aleppo, Mosul?
No, most of Islamic cities today suffer from the fate. I spoke about Damascus because I happen to know a little more about it than other cities. But I think, basically, the problems that I have touched upon are problems shared by most urban centers and most states in the Muslim world.
Thank you.
I was born in the city of Mecca with almost exactly the same system you just mentioned, and I don't know why it came to an end in a place like Damascus and stayed for so long after that in the city of Mecca. Until today, we have just some few remaining part of the system still existing. In every profession, there is a sheikh. And way down, there is what we call it Sabi.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the Mubtadi. You call him,
yes.
Mubtadi. And he will learn and then go up. But in the Hijazi system in Mecca, it was by election, because when the sheikh passes away for any reason, a new sheikh will be elected.
Yes. That's what happened in the
Masjid.
Selected, yes.
Selected,
so selected,
elected by the same
group.
Members of the profession.
Yes. That's
today,
so.
Until today, there is Sheikh Al-Saga, Sheikh Al-Jawahirjiya, Sheikh Al-Farrana, though we have electrical bakeries, but still we have a Sheikh Al-Farrana.
Yes. You were lucky.
Unfortunately, the new system now is changing these things.
Yes.
When it comes to education, the mosque in Mecca was almost a university.
Sure.
Yeah, and you have Sheikh al-Ulama. Now, Sheikh al-Ulama is not a great scholar. He's an administrator. And he will define the time and the places where the various jurists, scholars, and they teach not only religious things, they teach astronomy, mathematics, and so on, where they sit and the time for them, and how to organize that. You have also other professions. For instance, we have the Hajj, and we receive from the various parts of the world all kinds of pilgrims. So you have Sheikh Al-Jawa, a man who receives those who come from Indonesia and Malaysia. And then you have Sheikh Mashaikh Al-Jawa,
yes.
The man on top. And he does exactly, when you were talking about taxation, and he does exactly, he collects money from the Sheikh and pays the government what they own. That's before the time we had the oil,
yes.
And the revenues from oil. But until today, we have these systems existing in certain parts. The government is doing as much as it is possible to abolish it, but still we have something left in that.
Yes. Well, perhaps because you were never occupied from outside, there was a little occupation from Egypt during the
No, not really.
Wahhabi revolution.
No, not really. They just went to
Najd. But you—that's it. Because things remained, and it was working, operating, and perhaps the early phases of the Saudi regime in the Hijaz was not opposed to these, collaborated with them. It's working. Keep it as it is. With us, it's different. With us, there was from within a demand for change. With us, there was change of taste that I didn't mention, secular education that didn't happen with you. There was, if you want, a kind of Hanbali, latent revolution against the Mashayikh and the Turuq that Ibn Taymiyyah preached in Damascus, and he still is the biggest munition dump for the Salafis. And remember, the Salafis were also from us. Sheikh Rashid Rida. Yeah. Sheikh Rashid Rida was from Tripoli, and Hassan al-Banna, we trained him. And all these offshoots today are from us. And that is absolutely dead against what I described in these circles, in the conceptual frame of reference, in accepting mashayikh, accepting awliya, accepting the idea that you belong to also a world which is unseen, invisible. The early Hanbalite revolution that happened in Najd in the 18th century at the hands of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab would have gone down in history like any Hanbalite who, you know, declared his anger. And Ibn Khaldun mentions a whole list of them and says, without asabiyya, these will amount to nothing. But Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had asabiyyat al-Saud, the warlords of Najd. So combining the sword and the flag, southern Iraq was almost destroyed. Syria, it spread into it. And it triggered a movement in the Muslim world. In the Indian subcontinent, Shariatullah and Sayyid Ahmed Brevely, down to Abu al-A'la Maududi and his gang. It triggered a movement in in Libya, the Senussi, which is not a Sufi order, but actually a Salafiya movement. It triggered the Mahdist movement in Sudan. It triggered Ben Badis and the Rabat al-Ulama in Algeria. The results are with us now.
Have it right now.
It was a very devastating movement, the Salafiya movement, in uprooting. They came to weed the garden of Islam from irregularities. Granted, like any culture, you have irregularities. They plowed it. They brought the plow instead of weeding a garden that has roses and all beautiful things. They brought the plow and plowed it.
And we built a nursery called the University, Islamic University in Medina.
Right. For these,
we breed from all over the world
of course,
that nursery, and we send them back with the help of the oil revenues. Now we have a lot of exports,
yes.
Nigeria, Indonesia, and everywhere.
Yes, I know. They're also destroying our heritage in manuscript. They're burning in Yemen and Wadi Hadramaut. The other day I had a friend who reported to me how many libraries were burned by some of these Salafis. They say, what? Kitab, Tashayyu, Tasawwuf, feed them to the fire.
I think there is a Salafi who wants to talk to you.
Right.
Correct me if I'm wrong.
Please.
I couldn't catch the conclusion of your speech, what you concluded at the end.
At the end?
I'm saying that, let me tell you what I understood.
No, let me say, if you didn't understand it.
But let me ask the question first.
You didn't understand, and let me explain and then ask question. First, I said that we shouldn't lament something that died. I'd love to have my father and mother tonight with me in London. I can't have them. They died. What should be our attitude? Our attitude should be to try to develop institutions inspired by Islam that would counterbalance the military might of the state. That is the state of health.
So you are for Islam, big Islamic state? Yeah?
I'm not talking about big or small.
Yeah.
I'm talking about Islam wherever it is. I'm not after unifying Islam in one state. That again is a manifest impossibility since the breakup of the Abbasid Empire. Finish. We cannot go back and say all Muslims must be in one state, unitary state, and we must revitalize the Khilafah. We're dreaming. I'm talking about a system of social, economic, spiritual renaissance to develop the institutions that would counterbalance the military might of the state.
Thank you.